and welcome to the International Daily Roundup with People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from across the globe. Let's take a look at today's headlines. Report finds Filipino law enforcement did not follow protocol in anti-drug operations. Demands for justice echo across Argentina amid growing cases of femicide. UNHRC report reveals continued denial of justice to victims of Sri Lankan civil war. Millions of workers lead general strike to demand economic policy overhaul in South Africa. Over half of the drug operations launched by the Philippines police did not comply with standard protocols. Justice Secretary Minardo Gavera presented these findings during a UN Human Rights Council meeting on February 24th. An interdepartment investigation has shown that law enforcement officers did not follow standard protocols for the processing of crime scenes and cooperation with other agencies. The findings are based on over 5,000 case files in major provinces from where anti-drug operations were carried out. Suspects in all these cases were killed for supposedly resisting arrest or drawing a weapon and fighting back during official raids and anti-drug operations. However, Guevara stated that no verification or examination of the recovered weapon was ever conducted. This report comes months after a report by the ICC, which found reasonable basis to believe that the administration of President Rodrigo Duterte had committed crimes against humanity. The report found that the government had sanctioned extrajudicial killings of suspected drug users as part of its so-called War on Drugs campaign. According to government-reported figures, 5,810 people had died in official raids and drug-related operations by September 2020. However, extrajudicial killings by security forces, vigilantes, and militias pushed the death toll much higher. The Philippines Commission on Human Rights stated in 2018 that an estimated 27,000 people had died in drug war killings. Activists across Argentina are demanding an end to gender-based violence as the country witnesses growing cases of femicide. 21-year-old Guadalupe Gurual was murdered in the Neuquén province on February 23rd. She was fatally stabbed at night on a busy street, reportedly by her former partner. Her family has also stated that she had filed at least one complaint against him before her death. Gurual's death occurred 2 weeks after the femicide of 18-year-old Ursula Bajillo in Buenos Aires on February 8th. Bajillo was fatally stabbed at least 15 times by her former boyfriend and police officer Matias Martinez. As reported by the Buenos Aires Times, Bajillo had filed 16 reports of gender violence against him. She had also obtained a restraining order against him, however, this was never enforced. Martinez was later officially charged with femicide with aggravated factors of premeditation and cruelty. Days after Bajillo's death, Argentinian feminists led a march to the Plaza de Mayo in Buenos Aires on February 11th. As more reports of femicides were circulated, thousands also gathered in front of the Argentinian Supreme Court last week to demand justice for victims. The Observatory of Gender Violence has reported that 289 femicides occurred across Argentina in 2020. As reported by Telesur, 65.6% of these crimes were committed by current or former partners of the victims. Domestic initiatives have repeatedly failed to ensure justice to the victims of the civil war in Sri Lanka. UN High Commissioner for Human Rights Michelle Bachelet stated this while introducing her report to the UN Human Rights Council on February 24th. She further stated that successive governments had failed to promote reconciliation and pursue genuine accountability processes. Bachelet further highlighted the restrictions placed on the freedom of the press and civil society spaces. She argued that the growing militarization of key civilian functions had encroached democratic governance in Sri Lanka. The autonomy of key state institutions, including the judiciary, has also been eroded. Bachelet's report on the rights status in the country also emphasized the growing discrimination and persecution of Muslim and Tamil minorities in Sri Lanka. She pointed to the increased pain and distress caused to the Muslim community because of the forced cremations of people who had died due to COVID-19. The war in Sri Lanka led to deaths of over 100,000 people, with almost half of these being civilian deaths. Numerous allegations of atrocities and war crimes committed by the Sri Lankan armed forces were also reported during this time. A recent UNHRC report has also accused the current government of trying to sabotage efforts to put those guilty of human rights violations on trial. Bachelet has called for international sanctions against military officers accused of war crimes, as well as an ICC investigation into the war. For our final story of the day, we go to South Africa, where millions of workers led a countrywide general strike on February 24th. The call to strike had been issued by the South Africa Federation of Trade Unions, or SAFTU, to protest against the worsening economic crisis facing the working class. Here is a video feature on the general strike.
Government has got a moral responsibility of defending and protect its citizens. Government has got a moral responsibility to protect its workers in its own country.
Demonstration today is simply nothing but to actually outline the cries of the workers so that it could be perceived by the sitting Minister of Finance as he delivers his budget speech today. It's concerning that today we're going to be hearing a budget speech which will now start allocating funds. What are they allocating those funds based on when we have actually tabled our problems as the workers into the Labour Court, which needs to see to the decision of freezing the wage bill as well as cutting workers.
Comrades, this is the day in which we are out as served to in a national stay away, at the same time having coordinated some of the picket to simply highlight that it is the capitalist system that allows arrogant bosses. It is this system that breeds non-compliance. It is the system of capitalism that breeds no respect for workers' rights.
So we are supporting that NUPSO, the health workers in all health sector, must be given PPEs. The frontline workers must be given proper PPEs.
Well, it's now called employment and labor. I don't know which employment, because there's no employment. This Department of Labor, over time, it has become a dumping site of incompetent, useless ministers. Workers are not taken seriously. We are not taken seriously. So we worried about this character, that the right thing will be done. Comrades, we want jobs. We want employment. What we will never allow is for those jobs to be at the expense of our lives as Africans and black labor. Yes. We must refuse to do that. Yes. We want investments, but we don't want investments that we must use our brothers and sisters to pay for those investments. We want to urge the Department of Labor to say that government has got a moral responsibility of defending and protect its citizens. Government has got a moral responsibility to protect its workers in its own country. If government is not going to protect us, who must protect us?
Absolutely unnecessary. There is absolutely no reason to use that kind of force. After a bunch of security that they just threw unceremoniously into the police vehicle. He had just suffered a stroke recently and we asked them to release them. There was absolutely no law that was broken. I was part of that scuffle with the police officers and they attacked us first. They have been shown from the beginning they have not been interested in resolving the standoff peacefully. That has never been their intention.
That is all the time we have for this episode of the International Daily Roundup. For more such stories and videos, visit our website peoplesdispatch.org, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thank you for watching.